Can I just remind members that social distancing measures in place in the Chamber and to take care in observing them. The next item of business is a Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee debate on motion 24025 in the name of Edward Mountain on inquiry into construction and procurement of ferry vessels in Scotland. Can I say to those members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Edward Mountain to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Convener, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to contribute to this debate in my capacity as Convener of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee and to move the motion. Presiding Officer, we published our inquiry report into the construction and procurement of ferry vessels in Scotland in December 2020, over a year after we started it. And I would like to thank the many people who gave evidence to the committee, either in person or via written submission. And I'd also like to thank the clerking team who assisted us in the report. Now, we can only note the Minister's response to the committee's unanimously agreed report, which is very dismissive of our findings. On the public procurement side, our inquiry has revealed a catastrophic failure in CMAL and Transport Scotland's management of the procurement of vessels 801 and 802. We have concluded that the current procurement processes and structures are not fit for purposes. The Scottish Government's disdainful response to the committee's critical conclusion is frankly surprising. Contrary to the Minister's assertion in his written response that the committee did not highlight in detail the poor performance by the shipyard's former management as a contributory factor to the problems of this project, we did. It is clear, however, that the procurement process that the Minister attempts to defend was not fit for purpose. There can be no bigger failure in the process than the ability to identify at the outset that the bidder lacked the management and financial capabilities to fulfil the contract. That is precisely why the committee has called for an independent external review of the procurement processes. The Minister clearly needs to reflect further on this recommendation and to take steps to ensure lessons are learnt and that failures are not repeated. Turning to delays and cost overruns, the cost of delivering these vessels has ballooned from an original budget of £97 million to an eye-watering £200 million, and we are still counting. The ferries will also be delivered 4 to 5 years late, with islanders and other users paying a huge cost for these delays. The committee has called on Audit Scotland to undertake a detailed audit of the financial management of this contract. The committee, as I'm sure do taxpayers, welcome the Scottish Government's willingness to cooperate fully with this inquiry. Turning to commercial loans, there has been a complete amazement with the Minister's response to the issue of the £45 million of Scottish Government loans made to Ferguson Marine Shipyard. The committee highlighted a total lack of transparency surrounding the purpose, agreement, and payment of these loans. It is disappointing that the Minister appears to want to ignore these findings. These loans have effectively been written off following the nationalisation of the shipyard. It is therefore essential that the Scottish Government honours its commitment to cooperate fully with Audit Scotland in investigating the process it followed. The committee made specific recommendations to improve transparency and accountability with respect to future loans, and these must be fully considered and, where appropriately, implemented. Now, turning to the relationship between CMAL and female. The inquiry heard evidence that problems with the contract were not helped with the relationship between the former management of Ferguson Marine and CMAL, which became more than toxic. The Scottish Government's response records disappointment that the inquiry report does not reflect the extensive and proactive steps taken to facilitate and negotiate a better outcome with the contractor. It is clear, whatever those steps were, they failed. As the inquiry concludes, the Scottish Government should and could have acted more quickly and decisively to address these matters. It is notable that CMAL's first expressed concerns to the Government in March 2016 that the contract was running behind schedule. However, the doomed attempts at mediation were not initiated till a year later. At this point, it should be remembered that the contractor had received £74 million of the total cost of £97 million in contractual payments. Given this disaster, the committee believes there must be stronger provisions on the application and enforcement of dispute resolution mechanisms in future contracts, especially of this nature, to prevent any repetition. Turning to the engagement with local communities, one of the most concerning aspects of the delay and spiraling costs of delivery of these vessels has been the impact on island communities. The committee heard widespread dissatisfaction about the limited opportunity for local communities to input meaningfully into the ferries policy. I therefore welcome the Minister's commitment to bring forward a revised communications and stakeholders strategy. This strategy must include much better and genuinely meaningful engagement on the design and delivery of new ferries. Turning to the future decision-making structure, the committee inquiry has exposed a cluttered decision-making landscape lacking in transparency. It is clear all decision makers involved, including the Scottish Government, have failed to some degree to effectively discharge their responsibilities. We accept that plans are already underway to review the current legal structures and governance arrangements around the provision of ferry services. Despite the Minister's belief that the current tripartite arrangement works well, this review must reflect the root and branch overhaul that the committee called for. The Minister should be mindful of the committee's suggestion that this could go as far as result in certain bodies being merged or perhaps even abolished. Turning to the future procurement and construction strategy, the committee has concluded that the approach to procuring and delivering new ferries has to date been short-term, piecemeal, and lacking in strategic direction. On this basis, the forthcoming Islands Connectivity Plan cannot be a business-as-usual updated version of previous plans. We cannot afford to have an increasingly ageing and unreliable fleet which causes major service disruptions on a regular basis. The committee is calling for the committee is calling for nothing short of an overarching strategic long-term vision for all vessels serving Scotland's ferry network, underpinned by an appropriately funded plan to replace the entire existing ferry fleet over the next 25 years. Presiding Officer, in the short time that I've been allowed, I have focused my remarks on the key issues raised by the committee. The committee believes that the Scottish Government has a responsibility to face up to the catastrophic failures that have contributed to the myriad of problems with this contract. It is simply not good enough to dismiss the conclusions reached unanimously by this committee on a cross-party basis. One simply cannot blame the contractor for all the failings. Good leaders and good systems prevent failures. Poor ones don't. We must ensure that lessons are learned, that the costly and damaging mistakes that are evident here are never, ever repeated. We believe that reforms are needed to ensure our remote island communities remain connected, and that, Presiding Officer, is what the committee has highlighted in our report. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mountain. I call Paul Wheelhouse to open for the Scottish Government. Minister, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome to the opportunity to respond to the committee report today on behalf of the Scottish Government. And I'd like to take the opportunity, as the convener's done, to thank committee members and their clerks for the detailed work they've done and the consideration of what the report clearly acknowledges are broad-ranging, complex and important issues, and thank also the many stakeholders who fed into that, not least the communities themselves. We shouldn't forget that at the heart of these issues lie the communities that rely on the vessels in the fleet, the crews that operate them, and indeed the skilled workforce at the yard at Ferguson's. These key groups have been at the forefront of our minds throughout all of this and are why we stepped in to save jobs and the yard and to ensure the vessels will be delivered. At the outset, I also want to reiterate that, notwithstanding lessons learned, we remain fully supportive of the efforts of CalMAC, CMAL and Transport Scotland in delivering ferry services on the Clyde and Hebrides network, and indeed the work undertaken by CMAL to support services to the Northern Isles. However, as set out in my written response to the committee, we also recognise the challenges in doing their work and the need for continuous improvement, for investment and to optimise delivery of infrastructure to support our lifeline services. Along with my colleagues, particularly the Cabinet Secretary for Economy, Fair Work and Culture, I have taken time to reflect upon the content of the report. And as set out in my written response, there are some conclusions in the report with which we do not agree, and some instances where we believe the conclusion or recommendation doesn't necessarily fully reflect the breadth of evidence presented to the inquiry. However, and I stress this for the convener's benefit and other members of the committee, we do recognise that the committee focuses in relation to the two ferries and the delay in their delivery. The outcome has been particularly impactful on communities awaiting the delivery of ferries that have been yet to be completed, and clearly the cost outturn and delays are far from what was anticipated or desired at the point of contract award to FMEL. We accept that lessons have to be learned, and I want to reassure members that they are being learned. However, I would again reiterate our view that contractor failure played the primary role in these difficulties, and we are disappointed. I appreciate the convener's points, but this was not more fully reflected in the final report. Although I accept, as is the committee's right, the committee has the right to take its own view on these issues, but the government is also entitled to take a view as well. I would, though, also take this opportunity to refute comments made by some following publication of a reply to the committee, and it's clear from the commitments I'm about to reiterate that we have indeed reflected on the feedback and are already implementing improvements that colleagues may welcome. Presiding Officer, we've already committed to commission a study on the legal structures and governance arrangements which exist between the tripartite group of Transport Scotland, CMAL and CFL. This relationship was considered at length throughout the inquiry, and I can assure the Chamber that the organisations involved have committed to engage constructively in that review process and to reflect on the recommendations produced. However, we also recognise we want to safeguard areas in which the tripartite arrangements are judged to perform well now. Preparation for this project is well advanced, and we are currently evaluating submissions from advisers with a view to commencing this work shortly. And I'll update the committee on the initiation of the work, and ministers will also update the committee or its successor committee accordingly on progress and outcomes on that important work later in the year. We're absolutely committed to the principle that those directly affected by decisions around ferry services are able to engage in the decision-making process in a meaningful way, and I certainly note the convener's remarks around this being an important area of the committee's report. As was evident during the inquiry itself, there are often competing views from different groups, and it's important to balance these within our decision-making, and this will include consideration around value for money, around the lifetime costs of any investment as well. We have already begun the process of developing a revised communications and stakeholder strategy, and I welcome the positive feedback on Transport Scotland and CMAL's most recent engagement on the new Isla vessel provided to the committee by the CalMAC Community Board. And we'll continue to build on these improvements with stakeholders to develop greater transparency in how community views are received and included in our decision-making. In particular, we'll provide a clear explanation of why specific design decisions have been reached and why in instances where the community or individual preferences have not been reflected in the final outcome. Indeed, as an example of ongoing engagement, CMAL, CalMAC and the Transport Scotland held a webinar on the 14th of January to outline the analysis around the new Isla vessel options and how stakeholder views had helped shape the consideration and investigations currently underway, and there were 140 individuals who attended that webinar. We'll also publish a ferry stakeholder engagement strategy later in the year to improve engagement with communities. On due diligence, whilst audits have demonstrated compliance with public procurement procedures, we are committed to enhancements of arrangements where possible. And to that end, CMAL are committed to enhanced due diligence process for all contracts of value greater than £500,000. CMAIL also intend to engage the services of a shipbroker to enhance analysis around shipyards, including established track record, their skills and competencies, and first-class products. An additional level of assurance for tender assessment will be introduced by engaging naval architecture companies to support the process. I also note the committee's request to provide updates regarding costs and programme. We are committed to being transparent in reporting the progress on Hulls 801 and 802, and I note that Tim Hare from Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow provided an update to the REC committee on 19th of January regarding COVID-19's impact on production at the yard. It's my understanding that a further case of COVID was detected, with the individual being sent home from work and has been self-isolating, along with 11 suspected close contacts, in line with the test and trace procedures. And may I take a moment to wish a speedy recovery to those individuals involved. I note the convener and the committee's concerns regarding the purpose of the commercial loans provided to FMEL by the Scottish Government and sharing of information about them with CMAIL, which was referenced by the convener. And the purpose of those two loans is recorded in the contract documentation published on the Scottish Government website for September 2017 and June 2018 loan agreements, alongside the conditions and monitoring associated with the loans. We took great care to ensure proper separation between the two contractual spheres and could not share confidential commercial information with any of FMEL's clients, including CMAIL, without breaching its duty of confidentiality to FMEL at the time. However, Scottish ministers did have a full understanding of the complex commercial and contractual issues at play when taking decisions. Presiding officer, we remain committed to the actions I've outlined to Scotland's lifeline ferry services and to the communities they serve. The government's actions have also saved hundreds of jobs in Inverclyde and within the local supply chain, and I hope that is at least something we can all agree is a positive outcome. Thank you very much, presiding officer.
Thank you. And now Colin Graham-Simpson to open the Conservatives. Mr. Simpson, please.
Thank you very much. Can I start by thanking the committee for its work on this inquiry and for managing to unanimously agree a report and a set of challenging and robust recommendations. Now, I was looking through my dictionary for the definition of humility. It is to show that you are conscious of your failings. And normally, when a government is lambasted in the way this government has been in the committee report on the construction of ferries, the minister would have done just that. He or she would have taken the criticism on the chin, thanked the committee for its diligent work, promised to take the action they called for, and vowed never to let anything similar happen again. When I found the word humility in the dictionary, I also found two other words nearby, humble pie. And that is what the minister should have been eating. Instead, what we have had is my final word from my lexicon labours, humbug. The minister's response was nothing short of a disgrace, appalling, in denial, shameful, arrogant even. It was unbelievable from start to finish. In essence, the minister, or whoever it was from Transport Scotland who wrote his response, was saying to the committee, "We gave you the evidence, but you didn't listen to us, so you are wrong." At the heart of this is the complete failure to deliver two ferries on time and on budget. They are neither.
Briefly, Minister.
I'm grateful to the member. I'll keep this brief, presiding officer. Would the member acknowledge, in the speech I have just given at the outset of this debate, we have acknowledged significant areas where the report's made recommendations we have adopted? Are we not, though, also entitled to say where we believe the balance of the evidence said something different? We certainly accept the committee's report and we will support it, but we are identifying that there are some
not brief enough, Minister.
We disagree with.
Mr. Simpson?
I don't think he has accepted anything in the report from what he's said. The ferries will be up. You see, he's saying I'm not listening. It's just like he's told the committee, you didn't listen. The ferries will be up to 5 years late if they're ever finished, and the cost has more than doubled. If ferry owners CMAIL, a government body, was privately run, it would be out of business by now. The upshot is that the taxpayer is out of pocket, nothing new with this government, and the communities that the ferries are meant to serve have to put up with old vessels, much like the rest of our island communities. The committee said it believes there's been a catastrophic failure in the management of the procurement of vessels 801 and 802, leading it to conclude that these processes and structures are no longer fit for purpose. And anyone taking a rational analysis of what's happened would conclude the same. But the Minister, in his breathtaking response, says, "We do not accept the committee's description of a catastrophic failure." It's not his fault. It's not the fault of Transport Scotland. It's not the fault of CMAL, both arms of the government. The government and its bodies are, in his view, entirely blameless for what has gone wrong. There's nothing to see here now, so move along, please, everyone. Well, if Minister Paul Wheelhouse really believes that, then he should change his name to Paul Asleep at the Wheelhouse.
Nobody. Can I just say to members, sit down just a minute, I have no spare time in hand, right? So I'll just make that plain to members now. Minister, you can deal with this, you're summing up. So just to let you know, I'll give you a little bit extra, but I can't do it after this, I'm sorry.
I'm grateful. Nobody but the Minister and his chums in Transport Scotland and CMAL agree with his response. He should have been taking the committee's report and using it to knock heads together at both these organisations, but he hasn't. He frankly looks afraid to rock the boat with CMAL or Transport Scotland, the former of which, instead of showing some corporate humility, is actually expanding its empire. It's extraordinary. The committee said that a root and branch overhaul of current decision-making structures is urgently needed, and that this should consider the relative roles and responsibilities of all bodies involved in decision-making around the procurement of new vessels, and it should streamline the decision-making structures by merging or abolishing certain of them. They mean CMAL. What they are saying, and I agree with them, is we do not need CMAL. They also say that the next Clyde and Hebrides network franchise should be for a much longer period of time than is currently the case. That would give the operator the chance to take responsibility for the ferries, to procure their own, and get on with modernising an ageing fleet that is not fit for purpose. That's a model which is followed successfully elsewhere in the world, such as in British Columbia in Canada. One of the most concerning aspects of this debacle for me has been the loss of tens of millions of pounds in loans from the taxpayer. There's a pattern emerging here where the SNP government ploughs money into private firms, which is then lost forever. We've also seen it with BIFAB recently, but there's never, never a hint at contrition. It's almost as if it doesn't matter. At the end of the day, the taxpayer has lost out through this fiasco, but perhaps more importantly, so do the disgruntled island communities who deserve better, and that's why we need Audit Scotland to urgently investigate. The way forward is not to bury your head in the sand, but to listen to the MSPs of all parties on that committee who've said unanimously that wholesale change is needed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sims. I call on Colin Smith to open for Labour. Mr. Smith, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's much that can be said about this ferries fiasco, but it can be summed up in three words in the Rural Economy Committee's report: a catastrophic failure. Two ferries, £100 million over budget, double the planned cost and rising, and 4 years at least late, depriving our island communities of these lifeline ferries. Yet astonishingly, and I have to say arrogantly, the Scottish Government's response and the Minister's dismal letter to the committee is to say, and I quote, "The outcome has not been that for which we had hoped." The very definition of an understatement. It was a shocking response from a government that is in denial, out of touch, and thinks it's beyond criticism. No humility at all, and no apology again from the Minister today. Presiding Officer, it's just not good enough. Not good enough for Scotland's taxpayers, for ferry passengers, for the workforce at Ferguson's. They all deserve a lot better. Week after week during this inquiry, the committee received damning evidence exposing weaknesses at every part of the process and mistakes from every organisation involved. The clear conclusion: the procurement processes and structures are, and I quote from the cross-party report, no longer fit for purpose. A conclusion few could credibly argue with. It's why the committee were unanimous in calling for a root and branch overhaul of current decision-making structures. The committee hoped the report would act as a stimulus to improve how things are done, to ensure we never again find ourselves in this position, to create a ferry procurement system that is fit for purpose. Instead, the response from the government is, and I'm sorry to say this, tinkering at the edges of a process whose failings were not just graphically exposed by this fiasco, but in fact were already flawed. A process that is too disconnected from the communities our ferries are supposed to serve, too slow to replace our ageing vessels, and too short-sighted to provide certainty to the shipbuilding industry in Scotland. There has clearly been a case for a fundamental overhaul to the processes for some time, and this fiasco has just made that an urgent necessity. The committee's aim throughout was not to point fingers or lay blame needlessly, but to identify what went wrong, to learn lessons for the future. But the Minister's response makes me fear for the future. To be fair, I do sympathise with Paul Wheelhouse. He's been left to clean up the mess made by the inaction of previous ministers to meaningfully intervene when the government knew these contracts were going so badly wrong. And the failure, I have to say, of the First Minister and Derek Mackay to give evidence to the committee leaves us unable to answer questions over why ministers made the particular decisions they did and failed to take more robust action to intervene at an earlier stage. But, Presiding Officer, the refusal of the government to acknowledge the significant structural failures of the process does beg the question, what did go wrong, according to the government? Their answer appears to be that it's all down to failures on the part of Ferguson's Marine. The Minister said in his letter, contractor failure has been a very significant factor in the difficulties we have seen, highlighting, and again I quote, the contractor's non-performance, contract management and financial management described in independent evidence to the inquiry. The committee certainly highlight questions over these issues, including the management and financial capabilities at Ferguson. And we heard from the workforce whose own concerns were clearly ignored by Ferguson's management at the time. There is clearly a need, however, for Audit Scotland to undertake a more forensic inquiry into the financial management of the contract by CMIL, and I have to say the role of ministers in the process, including the awarding of loans to Ferguson's. But I do find it astonishing that the Scottish Government think blaming contractor failure alone is a good defence of the procurement processes which gave them the contract in the first place. If this entire fiasco is almost exclusively, and that's what the Minister said, almost exclusively as a result of the mismanagement, incompetence and the lack of capability on the part of Ferguson's Marine, then how were they awarded the contract in the first place? It exposes the fact that in awarding this contract, there was a clear lack of robust due diligence on the part of CMIL in assessing the financial stability of Ferguson's and its capabilities in areas such as project management and design. And it raises serious questions over the Scottish Government's willingness, indeed political desire, to proceed despite what we now know were significant risks. That deserves further investigation, and if necessary, I have to say, criminal investigation as to the awarding of this contract in the first place. This does not undermine Ferguson's at all. Indeed, quite the contrary. This yard was more than capable of delivering ships, but we know now it was not capable of delivering this contract. It's clear to me that CMIL failed in its duties when it came to due diligence, and the time has come to consider whether an organisation for which there does appear to be no legal requirement should actually exist at all, and in fact should be scrapped. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the one group of people who we are not to blame for this fiasco is the Ferguson's workforce, and I want to highlight the committee's recommendation paying tribute to the skills and dedication of those workers. That workforce have been a credit to the yard in the most challenging of circumstances. I'll say more in my closing comments about the future processes,
yes,
but we should pay tribute to the workers and the importance of maintaining those skills and that yard when it comes to future procurement of ferries.
Sorry, you must conclude, sorry. John Finney, please, open for the Greens, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Colleagues on the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee will know that I wasn't an enthusiast about this inquiry. I wondered what we could achieve other than a cursory examination of what are very detailed issues. I have to say the committee gave it its best shot, but I still believe that it wasn't going to bring one single ferry one day earlier to the constituents that I'm obliged to serve, and it actually was a distraction, not least from the catastrophic Brexit. The lead role in this lies with the Scottish Government. They have overall responsibility and they should have taken charge, and it's entirely reasonable for the health account. The Minister's letter has been alluded to. I won't labour the point. I think there's been points made about it. But to say Scottish ministers remain fully supportive of our transport agency, Transport Scotland of Caledonian Marine Assets Limited, that's simply disappointing. Now, the Minister rightly points out that these structures were in place before 2007, but then goes on to reflect on whether the governance arrangements between the tripartite bodies remain fit for purpose, having regard to the overarching objectives of effective, efficient and economic delivery of lifeline services. Really? Ministers don't know the answer to that already. I want to turn to CMAL, and most folks would go, who? And yeah, who indeed? I think we get a flavour of CMAL from a series of tweets they put out at the end of December, presiding officer. And I bear no ill will to any of the people that whose posts I refer to. They announced that they were appointing a new financial director who would be responsible for CMAL's financial strategy to provide efficient, cost-effective and safe ferries, harbours and infrastructures. Well, that would have been very good to have had that. Cost-effective is not building vessels that don't fit harbours. It is listening to your customers. And we saw the shambles with Isla Lewis and Aleppo. And notwithstanding the webinar, I fear we may be about to repeat it again with Isla. A head of support, they want, overseeing the successful implementation of strategies, plans and policies. That was clearly absent with 801 and 802. Now, the tweet that I did find interesting was that they were leaving the Port Glasgow headquarters temporarily to make way for an office expansion project. I'd make that move permanent. I'd a different sort of removal altogether. CMAL need removed from the equation, the so-called cluttered landscape where no one takes responsibility for anything. A protective shield for the ineffective Transport Scotland, both frequently missing in action in this, and a further buffer to Minister. Now, I'm going to turn to Ferguson Marine, and I would echo the comments of Colin Smith here. Outstanding skilled workforce, outstanding skilled workforce. But as regards the management, Mr McCall, initially not playing ball with us, jetted in from his tax haven with his film crews in tow, dumps a large dossier on the table, pontificates and jets out again. It suggested to me not a penny of his personal money went into this project. He wanted the profile, he had his chance, he failed. He has limited scope for criticism of others. He lacks credibility on this issue, other than as a failed shipbuilder. Self-evidently, things went wrong, but there is an opportunity. We're a maritime nation. We need a fleet of new vessels. We have a workforce with proven skills, with a yard. The yard was saved. And the Scottish Government should embrace the word nationalisation. There's up to their credit that they saved this yard and the community. But they do need to get a grip. And finally, I'd like to say about the operator, Calmac. The innocent party in all this, a six-year contract is inadequate. It should be much longer. The CEPA contract is 15 years. I would award it directly. And this would assess with direct, with forward planning, with fleet, show the fleet and infrastructure aligned. There's much to be learned here about an integrated transport system. There is a role for Audit Scotland. I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call Mike Rumbles to open for Liberal Democrats. Mr Rumbles.
Presiding officer, I want to re-emphasise to colleagues that the committee report was a unanimous one. We've heard that already. All committee members constructively engage with each other and with our witnesses throughout the process. What was the aim of our report? It was simply to influence the Scottish Government on how best to improve the system of ferry procurement. And to do that, we had to examine in detail what had led up to the situation where the current system had failed simply to produce the goods. By and large, committee members successfully resisted a partisan approach to this. I was particularly concerned that committee members did not divide on this report, because it had been my experience since our Scottish Parliament was established back in 1999 that we were far more likely to get the Scottish Government to act on our conclusions and recommendations if we worked constructively together to reach a unanimous report. And I thank my colleagues for working to do just that. We've done it. But that is why I'm afraid I'm so astonished and disappointed with the Scottish Government's written response to our report. Presiding officer, to solve a problem, you first have to accept that a problem exists. If that isn't done, then no matter how many constructive recommendations are made, they will be ignored. That is what the Scottish Government has so far done with our report. I quote from our report the words catastrophic failure. I quote, the committee believes there has been a catastrophic failure in management of the procurement of vessels 801 and 802, leading it to conclude that these processes and structures are no longer fit for purpose. The committee believes that the experience of the ferries contractors exposed a cluttered decision-making landscape that lacks transparency and where there has been varying degrees of failure by all of those decision-making responsibilities, including the Scottish Government. What is the Scottish Government's written response to our unanimous report? And I quote the Minister, "Scottish ministers remain fully supportive of our transport agency, Transport Scotland, of Caledonian Maritime Assets Limited, CMAL, and of Calmac Ferries Limited, CFL. So much for our unanimous view that the system is not fit for purpose." The Minister says, and again I quote, "I trust that the evidence provided by Scottish ministers has assisted the committee with its understanding of what is a well-established process with the party's roles and responsibilities clearly set out." And again from the Minister, I am satisfied that procurement in relation to 801 and 802 were undertaken fastidiously in good faith and following due diligence. Contrast that with one of our witnesses on being asked why a bid that was the highest quality, but also the highest price was successful. He responded, and I quote him, "I do not know the answer, but three things bring to mind. One is incompetence, another is vested interest, and the final one is corruption," unquote. Personally, I feel the answer to that question is simply incompetence more than anything else. But for the Scottish Government to turn a blind eye to the evidence from so many witnesses that there were real problems and many deficiencies in the whole procurement management system is quite mind-boggling. What I actually expected from the Scottish Government in its response to our report was an acceptance that things had gone badly wrong with everyone making mistakes along the way. What did we get? The Minister actually criticising the committee. I would, however, respectfully record some disappointment, basically criticising the committee for not blaming the management of Ferguson's even more. Presiding Officer, I said earlier that to solve a problem, you first have to acknowledge that there is a problem to solve. The Scottish Government is simply blaming the contractor, does not see its own failings and that of its agencies. I am sure now that our report will end up simply gathering dust on the Scottish Government's self, and there are not shelf, and there are none so blind as those who will not see.
Thank you, Mr. Rumbles. Thank you.
Of everybody's time, taxpayers' money, Minister, you really should have done so much better.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Time's very tight. Open debate. I call Stuart Stevenson, followed by Peter Chapman. 4-minute speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We would not be here today if the project manager and their office conducted their activities in relation to construction of 801 and 802 at Ferguson's Marine with anything approaching normal professional standards. It was not a mere contributory factor. Now, I make that observation as someone who's run projects of a similar financial scale and collections of projects, fact multiples of the scale of this project. The contract and processes around procurement were industry standard and had worked previously, and they're not just used in Scotland, but widely. The response of those in charge of procurement to the manager's failure, however, was inadequate and substantially contributed to why we are where we are today. Question: did CMAL know about the project manager's failures early enough to have intervened to minimise the damage? And my conclusion is almost certainly. Did the complexity of the procurement structure, which involved CMAL, Transport Scotland and the government, contribute to the problem? Yes, I'm pretty clear. It was more complicated than it needed to be. But the legal requirement to have that structure only ceased at 2300 hours on the 31st of December 2020. I've never said leaving the EU didn't have some advantages, and this might be just one of them. So I see Graeme Simpson nodding to that one. Question: in providing financial assistance to Ferguson Marine, should the enterprise agency have informed CMAL and others of doing so? And my answer, and here I differ from the quite strongly held views, I don't misrepresent them, I hope, of Edward Mountain, is that no, they should not have told them. Now, it's by not being told by the funder through proper oversight of the project, CMAL should have known by other means. Now, why? In providing support to a commercial company, the enterprise agencies must not discriminate in favour of state companies over private sector ones, although I heard Graham Simpson say we shouldn't be ploughing vast sums of money in a private company. It's unusual from those benches, but there we are. But the whole point is that we have to be blind as to whether it's a state company or a private sector company. There's nothing new about this. This is what's termed Chinese walls. Now, I'll just tell you a little story from my own experience. In the 1980s, my spouse was part of a team of advisors to the Distillers Company when they were bidding to purchase Bell's whiskey. For my part, one of my teams working for me was a part of the Bell's team on the other side of that takeover battle. There was clearly a conflict of interest in our household between our respective professional interests. The old saw is, he who would a secret keep must first keep secret that they have a secret to keep. My spouse and I discussed nothing about this and knew nothing of each other's involvement in this until 6 months after the event, having lunch with someone who raised the subject who'd been involved in it. That was the first time we knew we had been on opposite sides of a takeover battle on the stock exchange. That is how it has to work with the kind of Chinese wall. And so enterprise companies must do so in this context. But of course, the examination of the accounts receivable, the knowledge of where the business was getting its contracts for, would have been an important part for CMAR. Concluding, presiding officer, the primary failure definitely lay with the yard, but I do think CMAR could have done more, and I do hope, Minister, that we will look at that very carefully. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you very much. I call Peter Chapman to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Presiding officer, the REC committee's report into the building of ferries 801 and 802 was damning, and we decided that it was indeed a catastrophic failure. This was our view after a very comprehensive and detailed study of the facts, and indeed led to our unanimous conclusion. So Paul Wheelhouse's subsequent dismissal of much of our report was therefore truly shocking. Paul Wheelhouse has demonstrated an unbelievable degree of arrogance and a worrying degree of ignorance. His response amply shows what we already know about this SNP administration, namely that it shows a shocking level of incompetence, little understanding of business, and a cavalier attitude to wasting millions of pounds of taxpayers' money. Normally, individuals and governments learn from mistakes, but with attitudes like this, it is no surprise that industry has no confidence in this SNP government and that their economic growth rate continues to lag behind that of the rest of the UK. These ships will eventually be delivered, but will be 5 years late and at least 2.5 times over budget. And I know it from last week's budget statement that Fergus's Marine is to receive another £47 million in taxpayers' money this year. And yet, incredibly, Paul Wheelhouse says, and I quote, "I am satisfied that procurements for 801 and 802 were undertaken fastidiously, in good faith, and following appropriate due diligence." Really? Well, Minister, that is not what the committee found. Our experience was that Transport Scotland and CMAL applied inadequate due diligence in scrutinising and signing off the procurement process. There was a lack of scrutiny of the financial stability of the winning bidder, and the Scottish Government was willing to proceed despite significant risks associated with awarding the contract to Ferguson Marine. There has been a catalogue of errors and failings by ministers and CMAL, but I was particularly concerned to learn that 4 years after the contract was awarded, 95% of the sign-offs on the basic design of the vessels were still not completed. It is of grave concern that CMAL did not intervene to halt this process as soon as it became aware that Ferguson Marine was proceeding to build at risk without having secured a sign-off of the basic design. Presiding officer, these are the wrong ships given to the wrong yard, and the outcome is island communities across the West Coast suffering a poor and unreliable service. Their promised new ships are nowhere to be seen, and the whole CalMac service is stretched to breaking point. There is no spare ferry anywhere in the system, and if there is a breakdown or a ship needs maintenance, sea lines must be cut and islanders' essential journeys abandoned. This makes running a business on our islands already expensive and difficult, almost impossible. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, this is a debacle of the worst kind. It has cost taxpayers hundreds of millions of pounds, has made life for our island communities more difficult, and far from securing a reliable future for the Ferguson Marine Yard. I believe they will find it difficult to secure new work under the dead hand of this incompetent government and with the abysmal legacy of these ferries. The failure of this yard could well be the final disaster of this whole story saga. A sad end for a committed, skilled and reliable workforce who deserve so much better. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, first of all, I just want to touch upon a couple of comments that I've heard from colleagues. Peter Chapman there actually complained about the £47 million going into the budget for next year for that yard. And he also quoted it saying that the order was given to the wrong yard. His final comments actually were really quite astounding. I mean, if the order was given to the wrong yard, the yard would have shut. The yard wouldn't have been there. We wouldn't have over 400 people employed at that yard. So his comments are actually quite ridiculous. Then we've got the Greens. Remove CML from Port Glasgow. Take jobs away from Port Glasgow. Take more jobs away from Inverclyde. Then the Labour Party has Colin Smith's comments calling for a criminal investigation into the awarding of the contract. So Labour don't actually want the order, don't want the work at Ferguson and Port Glasgow. I'm looking forward to putting that in my election leaflet for May. And also in terms of Graham Simpson's comments earlier on, scrapped CML. And so that's jobs to be lost. And then he also complained about the loans, the £50 million and the £30 million loan. That finance, as well as other things, actually helped secure this yard and kept the yard. I've only got 4 minutes, Mr. Simpson. I normally do take interventions, but not today. So also, I note the report and the recommendations of the report, but I do respectfully disagree with parts of it. I do agree with some parts, but respectfully disagree with others. Not one person can state that what's happened at the yard over many years has been positive. Not one person. And as a constituency MSP for Greenock and Inverclyde, as someone who grew up in Port Glasgow, and also the son of a coppersmith whose last job was working at the yard, my loyalty has always been towards the yard. I want the yard, I'm sorry, I can't take any. I want the yard to succeed, I want the yard to build more ships, and I want the yard to employ more people and have a future for many decades to come. Now, I've never been particularly vexed about the ownership or the management of the yard. I'm not really a fussed as to whether it's a nationalised yard or whether it's a privatised yard. It's about the success of the yard. It's about the jobs. It's about the future. It's about apprenticeships. And certainly, as we currently stand, it's about the completion of these ships to ensure that we can build more ships in the future. Now, the report is full of many aspects, but what is clear to the independent reader is that the Scottish Government has consistently supported the yard and its workforce. And I'm glad that the committee itself have inadvertently recognised that by the final bullet point in section 71 and page 29. And my constituency, my community, welcome the fact that the Scottish Government have proceeded and saved the yard. From the awarding of the contract, which was won fairly, to the two loans of the £50 million and the £30 million, to the rescue of the yard, it's clear that this SNP government has more than stepped up to the plate to support shipbuilding on the Lower Clyde in my constituency. And I believe that the workforce, they know that, they know the local community knows that, and every single politician knows that, even though they will not say it publicly. Saying also, the report goes on to touch upon a number of things, including the future approach to standardising the vessels. And I agree with that. Robbie Drummond mentioned that certainly in his contribution. It's also in section 120. Section 129 in the evidence from CMAL about FMEL, changing strategy after winning the contract may go some way to helping explain section 96 and the damaging evidence from Tim Hare, the tunnelling director, when he said, and I quote, 5% of them, that's the sign-offs of the basic design, were completed and 95% were not completed when we took control of the yard in August 2019. Saying, officer, one thing is for certain, I want the future. I want as much work as possible to go to Port Glasgow, and not the hulls to be built in Vietnam or lower-cost countries, then brought to Port Glasgow, as described in the evidence on the 29th of January by Dr. Alf Baird, or also the scrapping of the two vessels as advocated in the same evidence session by Roy Peterson. That would have resulted in mass job losses and also the possible closure of that yard. Now, my constituency, my community knows it's this SNP government that saved that yard, saved the jobs, and they now have a future. Thank you very much.
Rhoda Grant to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're debating the abject failure of the Scottish Government's building of those new ferries. Meanwhile, the communities that serve struggle due to being badly served by old vessels subject to breakdown. We need a fundamental review of how we provide lifeline services to these islands and how we procure new ferries. We no longer need to tender these services. While we're in the EU, there were regulations, but even then there were exemptions to those regulations, such as the TECL agreement. However, now that we've left, there is no argument for this complex web of companies having a hand in owning and running our ferries. We need to abolish CMAL. There is a strong argument to say that CMAL should CalMAC should own, buy and procure ferries it runs. The last few vessel procurement processes have been proven to be vanity projects, looking for kudos for CMAL rather than fit for purpose ferries our island communities desperately need. Ferries themselves have been eye-wateringly expensive, and so have the alterations to harbours and that were needed to be able to allow them to berth. One would have hoped the boats were built to fit the harbours, not the other way around. Not one bit of this has provided a better service for islanders. We are now looking at a cost close to £200 million for two ferries that could have been procured at a fraction of that price. I'm told that a reasonable price to pay would be around £10 million. Add to that the cost of ensuring fair work practices for the workforce building them, and you would still almost have enough money to renew the whole fleet from what has been spent. Meanwhile, our communities suffer due to old ferries breaking down and having to make do with replacement boats that are not fit for purpose. Those vanity projects do not take into account the ferries have to move around the different routes, as we've heard in the debate, when maintenance is needed or indeed when breakdown occurs, because these ferries need bespoke harbours they will not be able to provide cover for other routes. What is also required is additional capacity. A relief vessel for winter maintenance periods would also add capacity in the summer when people struggle to get onto a boat. While one is procured, the Scottish Government need to look to lease a relief vessel, and Pentland Ferries have a spare boat. Why cannot an agreement be reached to lease that from time to time when the need arises? The sheer folly of allowing building to start on these ferries before this design was signed off is breathtaking. The fuel used is supposed to make them more environmentally friendly, but I understand that any benefit that might be gained would only be on journeys a lot longer than they will be taking. Therefore, they will not be more environmentally friendly, especially when the fuel is being shipped from the other side of the world. This also adds to their complexity, no doubt, and will no doubt leave them more subject to breakdown. You really couldn't make it up. The government's response to the committee clearly shows that no lessons have been learned. Presiding officer, there has been no apology, not for squandering the taxpayers' money, not for their incompetence, and sadly, not to the workers and the island communities that they have so badly let down.
Thank you very much. I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In a low and comfortable reading, I welcome the conclusions and recommendations of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee's report into the construction and procurement of ferry vessels, and thank the committee for its sterling work over many moons. I speak as constituency MSP for Cunningham North, which includes Arran, the community directly impacted by the lengthy delay in delivering into service Ferry 801, or the Glen Sannox, as it is now named. Along with obvious project management failures by Ferguson Marine, others with decision-making responsibilities, Caledonian Maritime Assets Limited in particular, and Transport Scotland, are accused of failing to discharge them competently and effectively. There was a lack of clarity regarding remit and no clear processes to escalate matters quickly when these went unfulfilled, resulting in mounting costs, delays and little progress. The vessels were originally due to be completed in 2018 and are now 5 years overdue, and COVID restrictions could delay this further. But let's go back to the beginning. Why was the Glen Sannox needed? Because many positive developments introduced by this government, such as the introduction of road equivalent tariff, which I relentlessly and successfully lobbied for over many years, huge increases in the number of summer sailings, addition of the MV Katrina on the Lochranza route, etc., all increased service demand. Together with the beauty of Arran as a destination and a rapidly ageing fleet, increasing adverse weather conditions with diminishing vessel resilience, all made at least one new ship essential. In scores of Arran ferry committees I participated in, Islanders argued for a couple of Finnlagan-style vessels more able to utilise a drossel and deliver a better all-year weather service. However, Transport Scotland and CMAL were intent on reinventing the wheel with a new world-beating design using liquid natural gas. Of course, when a contract was awarded, all seemed well, and I recall with no opposition, which has obviously been sharpened by hindsight. The price differential in accepting a foreign tender was not enough to outweigh the benefits of construction at a yard, an 8-minute drive from CMAL HQ, where an historic shipyard could also be revitalised, creating and sustaining hundreds of skilled jobs and an economic black spot. However, as progress faltered and stopped entirely, island communities had to endure the very real impact these delays imposed on island economies and populations. I was struck by the evidence heard of stakeholder engagement, which emphasised the need for decision makers to engage in a far more meaningful way with island communities about ferry procurement and construction. If communities don't feel their views have a material impact on the design and delivery of new vessels, dissatisfaction is likely to continue into how they regard day-to-day ferry services. I therefore welcome government commitments to improve community engagement, which must be meaningful with tangible outcomes to give the communities evidence they are being listened to and their views generally considered, which is vital to rebuilding the trust of islanders. Even when design choices are not clearly influenced by consultation, increased transparency should lead to a greater understanding of the considerations involved. Clearly, we need a comprehensive overhaul of the key decision-making processes around ferry vessel procurement. Islanders cannot understand how the current state of affairs was allowed to drag on, even after alarm bells began to ring back in 2017. An independent review based on the committee's findings and recommendations is needed urgently. And for too long, decision-making on new ferry construction and procurement has been delayed despite the repeated concerns of CalMAC, RMT, Islanders and other ferry users, as well as MSPs of all political persuasions, including me. Many ferries are significantly beyond their original planned operational lifespan, and more vessels must be ordered. With Transport Scotland already knows the views of island communities, this should happen now. Presiding Officer, we must absorb and learn from this report and take on board its findings to ensure this does not happen again. The commitments by the Scottish Government so far are hugely encouraging, but they must be fulfilled in ordering new vessels while ensuring a start date on site for the associated but seemingly never-ending Ardrossan Harbour redevelopment is essential to dock and service the Glen Sannox would be a very good start.
Thank you very much. I call Finlay Carson to be followed by Angus MacDonald.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Those of a certain age will remember a TV show called Blankety Blank, attracting millions of viewers every week. Well, it would appear that the Scottish Government is attempting to resurrect that show, but their version is certainly no laughing matter. Their version should be called Blank Check, with this scatter cash SNP government apparently happy to dish out money as if it was simply going out of fashion. How else can you explain its catastrophic failure in this disastrous procurement of two new ferries for Ferguson Marine destined for CalMAC? The undoubtedly skilled workforce in Port Glasgow Yard were due to deliver these ferries to serve in the Clyde and Hebrides network 3 years ago. Today, they're still tied up and will now not be completed until next year. And if we're lucky, the second might be in 5 years. More importantly, because of the incompetence of the Scottish Government, they are going to cost more than 2.5 times the original contract, nearly £250 million. Can you imagine coming home and telling your wife or partner or husband, I've just bought a new car. The garage was selling it for £10,000, but I told them I'd happily pay £20,000 and I'll pick it up maybe this year or maybe next or maybe the year after that. Even in this debate, Mr. Wheelhouse's response to the ferries fiasco still appears to be in line with other SNP debacles. Oops, we'll try again. Maybe learn some lessons, just like the Minister's R100 broadband failure. However, he should not be alone in shouldering the blame, as the then Finance Secretary, Derek Mackay, is also responsible for handing out loans to Fergus Marine whenever they came calling. This is the gentleman who promised to nationalise the yard without even knowing how much it was going to cost. And then we had Fiona Hislop, Cabinet Secretary for Economy, Fair Work and Culture, saying how proud she was last August of the progress that had been made since the Scottish Government took control. Does she not realise the ferries have not been delivered yet and are costing more than double the original contract? The Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee at Holyrood has already said the procurement process is not fit for purpose, but the Scottish Government pressed ahead regardless, despite the risks involved. The committee found that Caledonian Maritime Assets Limited, the Scottish Government's procurement body, and Transport Scotland's due diligence was inadequate. But why should we be surprised of all of this? It's not exactly the first time the SNP government have been woefully shown up. Take the Sick Kids Hospital in Edinburgh, which cost £150 million, yet still it's going to open late. And only after an extra £16 million was ploughed into rectified faults with the ventilation. What makes it worse is this government doesn't appear to listen. Ask the islanders who patiently waited and are waiting for these new ferries. Government ministers ignored their advice that the proposed ferries were not fit for purpose. Islanders arguing that they were too big. Indeed, it was only after the contract was signed did the Scottish Government realise they would have to spend another £50 million on the quayside infrastructures in order that the ferries could, in fact, dock. As the Shadow Minister for Rural Affairs and Natural Environment, I know how important these ferries are for the local economies who rely on them heavily. It provides remote communities with a vital lifeline to the rest of the country. Concerns have already been voiced over the overall age profile of Scotland's ferry fleet, with many now operating beyond their expected lifespan. Indeed, around 50% of the CalMac fleet is now beyond its 25-year expectancy, with inevitable breakdowns and cancelled sailings being experienced. So it should not be forgotten how critical these new state-of-the-art ferries are. It's just a pity the sheer incompetence of this SNP government has left our island communities paddling upstream without a paddle. Rather than you and your arrogant government burying your heads in the sand and learning nothing from the committee report, the government, and you in particular, Mr. Wheelhouse, should hang your head in shame.
I call Angus MacDonald to be followed by Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to take part in this afternoon's debate, not just as a member of the REC committee, but also as a regular user of CalMac ferries, not least the MV Hebrides, which is patiently waiting to be replaced by vessel 802. Now, we all know that Ferguson's has had a history of building good quality ships for the CalMac fleet on time and on budget for decades. Indeed, it's because of that quality of workmanship that there hasn't been the massive outcry you would expect on the islands of Lewis or Harris over the delay in delivering vessel 802, because the current MV Hebrides is such a good ship, faithfully plying the Uig Triangle day in, day out, weather permitting. And of course, it's worth remembering she was built by Ferguson's 20 years ago and is still going strong. In fact, she's probably the best ship in the CalMac fleet. So the proof is there that Ferguson's has delivered in the past excellent fit-for-purpose ships for the fleet, up until that is FMEL appeared on the scene. But there is clearly some disquiet on the islands at the prospect of further delay and the 802 not coming into service until between December 2022 and February 2023, not helped, of course, by the COVID pandemic, which has delayed work in the ferries by a further 6 months. So, turning to the committee's report itself, with regard to the procurement and construction strategy, the committee was extremely concerned about the overall age profile of Scotland's ferry fleet, with many vessels now operating significantly beyond their originally planned lifespan. We considered that the current situation reflects a failure by successive administrations in Scotland to develop and implement an effective strategy for renewing the fleet. So to that end, I was delighted to see in the Minister's recent response to the committee that the government will invest at least £580 million during the next 5 years to build on their vessel replacement and deployment plans, which we're assured will improve resilience, reliability, capacity and accessibility. Looking to the future, and in particular engagement with local island communities, During our evidence sessions, both CMAL and CalMAC claimed strong levels of engagement, with Robbie Drummond of CalMAC stating that they undertake hundreds of meetings per year with local ferry committees and ferry stakeholder groups. And Jim Anderson of CMAL stated that engagement with local communities has been extensive, and that the design of vessels 801 and 802 were responsive to the needs and expectations of those local communities as a result. With specific reference to 802, Mr Anderson claimed, and I quote, "The communities are, by and large, getting the ship that they want. The ship is like the MV Hebrides, and we know that they're very happy with the Hebrides. I would say that the ship will be Hebrides Plus when it's finished," which was music to my ears, convener, but sadly not to Corner Nail and Shears, which claimed that offering a vehicle deck capacity increase of 25% compared to the vessel it's replacing, vessel 802, will only partially alleviate capacity issues on the Uig Triangle. It also suggests the decision to provide the service with a single new vessel was contrary to the preference of the local community, which reminds me of the situation with the now six-year-old MV Lough Seaforth. The community originally wanted two smaller ferries operating the Stornoway to Ellapool route instead of the one larger ferry that they got. So it's fair to say that there's still room for improvement when it comes to engagement with local communities, and I'm glad the Minister has acknowledged that. In closing, Presiding Officer, it should not go unnoticed that the Scottish Government, which faced an unprecedented and most unwelcome predicament, which I'm sure none of us would envy, took action to secure the future delivery of the vessels to serve the island communities which rely upon them, and also secured hundreds of skilled jobs and wider economic activity. For the record, that is some 350 employees at the yard, including permanent, temporary and contract workers, which also includes 26 apprentices. And of course, the yard also supports an estimated 350 jobs in the rest of Scotland. The saving of one of Scotland's last shipyards cannot and should not be disregarded or undermined. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Alistair Allen, who will be the last open debate speaker.
Presiding Officer, the committee's report is unambiguous. As others have pointed out, there were indeed, it seems, catastrophic failures associated with the building of two vessels for CMAL. Some of those failures may be attributed to the process of procurement by CMAL, but many clearly are also attributable to the way in which the project was managed by the contractors then operating Ferguson's. The people not to blame are the workforce of Ferguson's themselves. I'm neither going to minimise all of those facts nor rehearse them again. Instead, I want to look at some human consequences. Much of the discussion so far today has very legitimately concentrated on what this episode means for jobs in Inverclyde. Now, given the proud heritage of shipbuilding there, I readily understand and sympathise with that focus. Indeed, it was, I believe, quite right that the government stepped in when it did to save the jobs. However, like Kenneth Gibson, I want to add a word now about what the delay to those vessels actually means for island communities. Vessel 802, which is now running some 4 years behind schedule, is intended for the route that runs from Uigan Skye to the islands of Harris and North Uist in my constituency. CalMAC, of course, already has vessels which currently run on those routes. However, because of a period in the first few years of this century when no new major vessels were built for CalMAC routes, some of the current fleet, as we have heard, are now becoming distinctly stricken in years. The pressing need for new tonnage to serve island routes becomes strikingly clear in the summer, at least in any normal summer, when CalMAC can simply no longer meet hugely increased demand. Less widely highlighted, however, is the problems CalMAC and the communities it serves now face in the winter, when the fleet is shuffled around while many vessels have their annual refits. Only at the end of the year, three of CalMAC's largest vessels were out of action at the same time, meaning that the company could not cover all lifeline services. Only a few combinations of ships and piers are actually interchangeable. Add bad weather or vessel breakdown into the picture, and the situation now becomes extremely difficult to manage. At Easter 2018, for instance, Lochmaddy in North Uist went without any ferry service at all for the holiday long weekend, with that waiting list stretching to nearly 3 weeks. Those kind of sustained ferry problems have significant consequences it can become difficult to keep shops stocked. It can become impossible for families to attend funerals. Tourist businesses are unable to honour bookings. So, Presiding Officer, obvious and unhelpful though it may be for me to say this, I just want to end by observing that with the best will in the world, a Calmac ferry does not take 6 years to build. The nearest comparison that comes to mind is the line of Queen Mary, which took 5.5 years from the laying of her keel to her maiden voyage in 1936. She, however, was then the largest ship in the world, and work had stopped halfway through her construction because of the Great Depression. So, Presiding Officer, I think it would be remiss of me not to take this opportunity to focus at least some of the debate on the need to ensure that these two vessels are completed soon, and to ensure that another vessel intended for Islay is ordered, or more importantly, completed soon too, in order to ensure that the Calmac fleet can cope in the years that lie ahead.
Thank you very much. We now move to closing speeches, and I call on Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate has highlighted the fact that there does remain many unanswered questions. That's why so many of the committee's recommendations called for further investigation, for example, by Audit Scotland, and for reviews of the procurement process, the design development and vessel specifications and propulsion technologies. And as I've already made clear, it's my view that there does need to be further investigation into the decision-making process over the awarding of this contract in the first place. But although there are unanswered questions, there are some unavoidable facts. The building of these ferries in the It was a catastrophic failure, and in the words of the committee's report, it exposed serious failures in the current tripartite decision-making processes. In calling for an urgent root and branch overhaul of the decision-making structures, we specifically noticed that this should, and I quote, consider the relative roles and responsibilities of all bodies involved in decision-making around the procurement of new vessels and whether each of these bodies should, in fact, continue to exist. It's becoming increasingly clear that there is no longer a need for CML. No, we are not subject to EU procurement laws, and the failure to carry out due diligence in the awarding of this contract should hasten that decision. I have to say, a failure that Stuart McMillan says should be swept under the carpet. He says that we should simply keep CML a failing organisation because it creates jobs. He seems to not to understand that the jobs will still need to be done, but taking ferry building fully in-house would simplify the procurement process, improve accountability and ensure better alignment with communities' needs and wider government policy aims. I don't know if I've got time to take that. No, very briefly, I think, is the signal. But
Stuart McMillan.
I thank Colin Smith for taking intervention. At what point did Mr Smith, did I actually say that?
Colin Smith.
You made it absolutely clear, Mr McMillan, that you did not support the scrapper of CML. You actually specifically talked about the jobs that were being created there. And I just wonder, Mr McMillan, how many jobs could be created with £100 million that's been swept into the Clyde because of this ferry fiasco from your government? No. It's vital also, well, it's a point that Mr McMillan ignored in his speech, but it's absolutely vital. Not only should we look at the structures of the way in which contracts are procured, that ferry building itself should be properly aligned with wider policy, including, I have to say, our ambitious carbon reduction targets. The Scottish Government must look at what more can be done to support low carbon technology in our shipbuilding sector to reduce emissions and create those vital green jobs here in Scotland. There are some exciting projects underway here in Scotland, such as the High Seas 3 project in Orkney, which I understand is seeking funding through the UK Government's Clean Maritime Demonstration Programme. If we're serious about building a green economy, work like this must be supported. And we want to see that supported in shipyards in Scotland. So that brings me on to the future of Ferguson's Marine Shipyard. The government have been keen to emphasise the role they played in protecting the shipyard's future by bringing it into public ownership. Now, I fully support that decision, but it should never have been allowed to escalate to that point in the first place. It should not, frankly, have been necessary. This fiasco led to the demise of the company behind Ferguson's, not something we should be celebrating, which certainly came across in some members' speeches. It was clear from the committee's inquiry that despite the failings of the management and the financial model for the company itself, that Ferguson's has a dedicated and skilled workforce, making it an invaluable asset to Scotland's shipbuilding industry and an important source of jobs in the local economy. Having made that welcome initial intervention to save the yard, the focus must now be to work to protect its long-term future by investing in and developing the skills and expertise the yard has and ensuring it is equipped to deliver the cutting-edge green technology we will need and it secures the contracts that it can deliver. We need a joined-up strategic plan for shipbuilding and ferry services in Scotland. As well as revisiting the procurement process for the shipbuilding process, the Scottish Government also needs to set up plans for awarding contracts for lifeline ferries. But the Government does need to learn the mistakes from this fiasco. But for that to be possible, I have to say to the Minister, the Government cannot continue to be so dismissive, of so many of the committee's recommendations. It should remember fundamentally that what we have in this contract is £100 million of taxpayers' money wasted, and most importantly, we have lifeline ferry services not being delivered to communities that have had to wait far too long for the delivery of this contract.
Thank you. I now call Jamie Halcrow-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This debate comes at an important time following the Rec Committee's report. And can I thank the members, clerks, the convener, my colleague Edward Mountain, for what was a clear and comprehensive examination of this subject. As a new member of the REC committee, I didn't participate in the work that's taken place over the last year. However, as an islander, I'm all too aware of the issues that our ferry networks have faced. At the heart of all of this are two vessels and hundreds of tons of steel sitting on the banks of the Clyde. It's a story as tragic as it is ridiculous. It all started quite differently. The easy promises, the First Minister's launch of the Glen Sannox in 2017, with only the Potemkin-esque painted windows hinting at the trouble ahead amongst the sea of little flags issued to schoolchildren. But instead of sailing the clear waters of the Clyde and Hebrides, as they ought to now be, what the Scottish Government has created is a pair of grandiose monuments to their own incompetence. And our island communities, not to mention the taxpayer, have been left with the consequences. The committee's report in December was damning. And those two words, repeated many times today, catastrophic failure, should haunt all those responsible. The report told a tale not only of enormous delays and cost overruns, but of huge flaws from the start to the end of the procurement process, missed opportunities for the Scottish Government to mitigate problems at earlier stages, and a deaf ear turned to concerns from numerous parties. Over the summer, the Glen Sannox was pulled into dry dock, its frame having been left exposed to the elements too long and remedial action needed. Glasgow has the fish that never swam. Port Glasgow, the ship that's never sailed. Since the tide so publicly turned on the project, the Scottish Government has created a legacy of evasion, trying to shift blame at every opportunity, suggesting that it was all the fault of Ferguson Marine, with innocent ministers the real victims, dissolved under the light of the committee's investigation. And my colleague Graeme Simpson highlighted that as he spoke about the Scottish Government's response to the report and the Minister's lack of humility or acceptance of the lessons to be learned. But Paul Wheelhouse can no longer ignore a five-year delay and a nine-figure overspend. Given his record with East Ferries, the broadband rollout and the proposed publicly owned energy company, the Minister for Energy Connectivity in the Islands is fast gaining a reputation as the Minister for Delays. But of course, as Finlay Carson and others rightly pointed out, Paul Wheelhouse isn't the only politician with questions to answer. He's just one of the SNP ministers involved in this shameful affair. And stay-at-home politician Derek Mackay should be here too, or at least joining us remotely, to answer questions. But he isn't. And Peter Chapman took up the gulf between the committee's findings and the report and the government's response. Significantly, the issues around Transport Scotland and CMAL's oversight and due diligence have been a constant theme of discussions. He also mentioned an issue that I know is close to the hearts of islanders, and businesses especially, resilience. Ferry services that cannot adapt when normal operations break down, and where faults lead inevitably to lost journeys. Presiding Officer, what today's debate has shown is the lack of strategic planning within the Scottish Government for our ferries, an issue I've raised in this chamber for many years. These ferries are vital to our island communities, and should be driven by the needs of islanders. As the committee notes with some alarm, the ageing profile of our ferry fleet, that lack of built-in resilience and the short-termist approach that has been taken. We see it too in the Northern Isles, with still no answers from the Scottish Government on the future of the inter-island ferries that will themselves need replacement. All the while, private operators seem to be able to commission new vessels on time and on budget. And the fear is this. So long as these long-standing issues remain unanswered, surely it will only be a matter of time before the SNP's next catastrophic failure comes along.
Thank you. I now call on Paul Wheelhouse.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And after that kind of underwhelming contribution from Jamie Halker-Johnson, I will not take any lessons from someone who pulled less than 500 votes to get into this Parliament about role. And Julian Fellowes need not look out for any fear that he'll be replaced as a Tory scriptwriter for Lines. In respect of other contributions, I would like to, more positive contributions. Rhoda Grant raised, I appreciate, is online and cannot contribute. And Stuart Stevenson raised issues to do with state aids and the replacement to that. It's clear, yes, there is a different environment now post-Brexit, but we also have to take into account that we need guidance from the UK government around how the subsidy arrangements will now be made before we can start to draw conclusions about the implications for direct award, although we are interested in looking at that. There are a number of other positive contributions. Colin Smith, I appreciate much of what he said may be less positive, but I think he was calling for a tripartite review, as others were. I just wanted him to acknowledge, and others' colleagues to acknowledge, we have committed to that. It is about to be commissioned. It will report to Parliament and to ministers. And I reassure him and others that almost... I'm not sure I have time, but if the presiding officer allows me, I can yeah, absolutely.
Graham Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for taking the intervention? Are there any circumstances under which he would consider scrapping CMAL?
Paul Wheelhouse.
In terms of the point that Graham Simpson raised, we obviously have to commission the review and see what comes forward. I am praising the work that CMAL and CalMAC and Transport Scotland do. I acknowledge there are lessons to be learned. I have said that in my opening remarks and in my written submission. We will learn the lessons, I promise that, but we also need to wait for that review to conclude what are the ideal arrangements given the kind of procurement models we need to look at going forward and to try and get the investment in the fleet. So I think with respect to him, I understand what he's trying to get me to say, but we have to see what is recommended as the best organisational structure going forward to ensure that we have the appropriate steps in place. Alistair Allen was right to focus on the communities, and I hope he would acknowledge, as would Kenny Gibson and others, that I have been in contact with communities, and I have given them absolute assurance we're doing everything we can to get vessels in place in time, and expressed my regret that they are facing delays as a consequence of what's happened at Ferguson's. Mike Rumbles charged us with the risk that this report will sit on a shelf and gather dust. I can assure him it will not. We're already acting on a number of the recommendations now. And I would hope that even the convener acknowledged some areas he welcomed in his opening remarks, including our willingness to contribute to any Audit Scotland review should that be asked for by Audit Scotland. And indeed, I don't think I have time, Presiding Officer, so apologies, but I will happily engage with a member afterwards. In terms of the wider contributions, we have certainly signalled, as I say, that we remain committed to those communities and to take on board lessons. We've recognised the impact the delays have had. We've given additional investment to CalMAC through CMAL for £4 million a year to help with additional maintenance costs as we try to bridge the gap between the vessels arriving. And in recent months, we've also made significant progress around other key vessel replacement projects, the appointment of naval architects for the Gurwick to Dunoon and Kilcreggan vessels, approval of initial stages of the small vessel replacement programme. That will see seven of the Loch-class vessels replaced in a rolling programme. In addition, CMAL have commenced work on the options around replacing the freight vessels for the Northern Isles. Our infrastructure investment plan that Angus MacDonald referenced has committed to £580 million of investment in ferries over the next 5 years. And we're also looking at whether or not there are positive lessons we can take from the impact of COVID on services, and in particular considering, not least inspired by discussions with Dr. Allen and colleagues in the Western Isles, about retention of an appropriate percentage of tickets on a turn-up-and-go basis, whether that should continue, which is of more benefit to islanders looking to travel at short notice, given capacity constraints. And I make these points to stress that whilst we will reflect and improve, as I've set out, we'll also progress these vital projects. And some of this work may also require port infrastructure improvements to support the introduction of new vessels with larger capacity and to accommodate standardisation of vessels, which is something the committee and witnesses have called for. And that references a point that John Finney made in his remarks at the beginning. But these costs will be understood through the development of the project and tested against a detailed cost-benefit analysis across the lifetime of a vessel's life. We're also committed to ensuring this work is underpinned by an overall investment strategy that considers both ports and vessels and support all of this with the development of the Island Connectivity Plan. I think the convener mentioned this earlier on. That will be the successor to the current ferries plan, and we'll look more comprehensively at connectivity for islanders to the mainland. And we continue to welcome the commitment and professionalism of the workers and management team in the yard at Port Glasgow, and we'll update the committee at appropriate intervals around the progress with completion of both hulls 801 and 802, and we firmly stand behind our decision to step in and ensure jobs for Inverclyde, a future for the business, and to ensure that vessels are delivered. And Stuart McMillan is absolutely right to focus on that. Presiding Officer, as part of the intervention, we have reluctantly, very reluctantly accepted the additional costs brought about by the failure of the contractor to deliver on the fixed price they promised, underpinned by failures in processes by the former management, as set out in the report of the turnaround director when the yard was brought into public control. That does not mean, though, that we do not accept things have to change. So I accept members are making these points, but we have acknowledged that. Even in my written submission to the committee, we have acknowledged that we are not entirely resting this on contractor failure, but it was, as I say in my contribution, a very significant factor in the problems that have unfolded, and we hope members who are fair-minded would accept that. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister, and I call on Maureen Watt to wind up on behalf of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Dr. Mike Rumbles.
Presiding Officer, you will be aware, I made a point of order last week on the inability to make interventions, obviously, when people are making a remote contribution. And I asked whether you would take that forward, and you suggested we give it bring it to the attention of our business managers. Similarly, today, we've got an issue that the Bureau, again, have programmed this debate. It's a really important debate in a very short period of time, meaning that members... Mm-hmm. Other than the front bench, can only contribute 4 minutes, and quite rightly, they don't have time to take interventions. This is not a debate. The Parliament is turning into a process of speech after speech after speech. This is not a debate, and I would really hope that the Business Bureau takes note of this.
Thank you very much. I'm not at all sure this is a point of order, but in any case, it is important to say that what the Bureau proposes, Parliament agrees or disagrees, and the timing for this debate was agreed by Parliament. I call on Maureen Watt to close for the committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I hope that intervention hasn't eaten into my time. This has obviously been a rambunctious debate on the Rural Economy and Connectivities Report, which had to be debated in this chamber. And while there's been mentioned that there wasn't a minority report, it would be fair to say that there was robust discussion and disagreement in the committee, and it's thanks to the clerks that we managed to get to this point to help us in our work to have this report, and I thank them for it. Holding an inquiry was agreed by the committee, and it's rightly so, because there's a considerable amount of taxpayers' money involved in ferries generally, and specifically with 801 and 802. And as members have said, many of our island communities are and will be affected by the slippage in the procurement of new ferries in what is an ageing fleet. The government and the minister must accept that changes are necessary, and I'm pleased that consultation, for example, with islanders will be improved, and above all, that feedback is necessary for them. It's a very important part of the process of engagement, and the wants of islanders are not some homogenous ask, and the needs of the wider economy, such as tourism and business, all need to be factored in. The Scottish Government must look to have standard designs for small, medium and large vessels to get economies of scale and to have better coordination of key sizes and key facilities throughout the Western Isles and the Northern Isles so that we can take into account the various needs of islanders but have some coordination and standardisation, especially as propulsion methods will change going forward to take into account climate change. It really was important to have this debate to hear the contributions from those who represent the islands in our country. And it is important to say that tendering and procurement of ships is unique and there has been a long-standing process, and it's unlikely to change significantly just because of ferries. But there is room for better design specification and the requirements in the tenders to be more specific. We do want a shipbuilding industry to survive in this country. It has been a consensus throughout this debate. And I think it would be unthinkable not to have a vibrant shipbuilding capacity in Scotland, which is an island and has lots of island communities to serve. It's clear that Ferguson Shipyard, as long as it's in public hands, will be a subject for debate in future parliaments, and that government should be held to account on this subject. There is much to be done to turn around this business, and it will take many years to put it on a sound financial footing. And the government is right to look forward, but it is important that we question the current decision-making structure, especially, for example, the length of the CalMac contract. It should be longer. However, in conclusion, presiding officer, those speakers who also visited the yard cannot have but have seared in their memories what we saw as a result of FEMA's tender of the yard. Parts and machineries of the vessels stored in appalling conditions without sufficient inventory in place. Steel of insufficient quality to hold the bow doors in place. Capstans of insufficient strength to hold the ships in port. No pipework from the LNG tanks to the engine room, not to mention the infamous bulbous bow, all having to be replaced at huge cost due to the incompetence and negligence of FEMA. All in all, Scotland must, as I've said, have a sustainable shipbuilding industry, and in Inverclyde, we must have a yard that's in a position to be competitive. Inverclyde, as Stuart McMillan has said, is one of the most deprived areas in Scotland, and it's really important that this government continues to support that yard. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That concludes the debate on the inquiry into construction and procurement of ferry vessels in Scotland, and we will move on in a moment to the next item of business.